Another exciting episode of AGTV. We are so excited on today. Again, we want to just say welcome on behalf of our executive producer and founder, Davis Ikasi Otu. I am your host for this episode, Rosalind G. Guys, we have a great episode on today. We have with us all the way from Nigeria, Africa, Archbishop Idem Ikon on today. So at this time, Archbishop, welcome to AGTV.
Thank you very much.
So much, sir, and welcome
thank you very much.
To these United States as
God
well.
God bless you.
We are certainly honored and privileged to have you with us on today and just to spend some time with you to talk about the goodness of our God.
Thank you.
So on today, I just want to start off with our interview by asking you about your born-again experience. How did you come to know our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ?
I grew up in a religious home. My parents, my mother went to church. My father went to church once a year. So he made all of us go to church every week.
Okay.
So literally we grew up in the church. I sang in the choir as a little boy, you know.
Yes.
But this particular day we had a man of God in the church. He was a committed man of God in an organization, a denomination that, you know, did not believe in the Holy Ghost. But he was spirit-filled.
Okay.
And we didn't know that because we didn't know anything about
knowledge, right?
That's right. So, and one day he began a series, and he preached for 2 weeks. And every time he preached, something happened to me.
Yes.
But on this day, the 26th of November, 1967, he mm-hmm. preached on Jesus. He talked about Jesus from Revelation, from Genesis to Revelation.
Yes.
And you know, because I was inclined to the sciences, I was good in mathematics.
Yes.
His argument was excellent.
Right.
You could not fault his argument. So my senses mm-hmm. could capture what he was saying. I could understand what he was saying as much as my spirit man was dead. I mean, I can say that from hindsight now.
Right.
I decided to go to the pastor and shared my heart with him. I said, I didn't understand what you were talking about, but this is my life.
Yes.
And when that happened, he told me to pray. And I prayed a prayer that I've prayed about 4 or 5 times in my life since then.
Yes.
Oh God, help me. 4 words. Oh God, help me. I never knew what to say again. But when I got up from my knees and knelt down to pray, when I got up from my knees, I was floating. Something happened to me, and I literally floated out of the man's house. Well, that was the experience I had, and ever since, my friend said, I'll give you 2 weeks. This will be over, and you will come back to us. But it's over 40 years now. And
wow, that's amazing.
Getting better every day.
That's
yeah.
right. What mm-hmm. a unique spiritual experience.
Yeah, it was. I could not trade it for anything else in my life.
Yes. But at that point, you knew, you know, the decision was made in your heart.
That's
that
right.
Your faith
completely
was going to be in Jesus Christ.
As a matter of fact, I never knew that you had to make a decision. But that was a decision.
Right.
You see, we get so technical about things mm-hmm. today. Mm-hmm. I never knew I had to make a decision. Right. But that was a decision
That's
I made.
Right. That's right.
I said, I told myself I will not eat until I get this thing straightened out. I never knew it was called being born again.
Right.
I didn't know it was called being saved.
That's right.
But I knew I needed him.
That's
And I said to myself, if I don't sort this thing out, I will not eat.
Wow.
And that's why I went to the pastor's house just after church. You know. So.
Wow, the most important decision that you've ever
that's
made.
That's right. That's
and I
right.
love what you said. You said you never looked back.
Never.
So never. So on that line, your call into ministry, how did you know that you had a call?
As soon as that happened, all the friends that we used to go out partying together, mm-hmm. I happened to have been sent a kind of leader, even when I was not saved.
Right.
So
okay.
They all gravitated towards me and were in church. We were fasting, we were praying, we were talking to God. We never knew it was called seeking the face of God, but we wanted an intimacy with him. And so I was baptized in the Holy Spirit at home.
Okay.
In
okay.
our evening prayer.
Wow.
Family at home. I was baptized in the Holy Ghost. I began to speak in tongues. My sister, who had an asthmatic attack, I laid my hands on her, and she instantly got healed. And then I saw a vision. I prophesied. Teachings are good because they would have maybe catalyzed my speed,
yeah.
But the women. And that's why I preach that the women should wake up and discover who they are. It was the women in the church. The men never observed anything, but the women in the church, in January of 1968, they had a big campaign, evangelistic campaign. And they took me along with them. I was barely 18. And they put me up, and I began to preach. They wanted me to preach. And they were all awestruck as I was preaching because they never heard that before. So that's how I began to preach at the age of 18. So much later on in life, I went back to the university to continue my dream of being an engineer.
All right.
I read electronics and electrical engineering. Mm-hmm. But midstream, God stopped me. And said, I want you to go and preach. That was in 1973. I was praying in the Christian library in the university. Mm-hmm. And I heard God speak to me. I mean, if it was not audible, it couldn't have been clearer.
Yes.
And he said to me, I want you to go and declare my word into all the ends of the earth. I will take care of my bills and your bills. And that settled it.
Wow.
It wasn't easy. I felt I was stupid.
In what respect?
I was living a career. I had scholarship from the oil company.
Mm-hmm.
I had scholarship from my state government. And I was going to throw these things away.
Mm-hmm.
People were looking for the opportunity. I had it. Mm-hmm. On a silver platter,
mm-hmm.
and I was going to throw it away because of the gospel. We didn't know. I didn't know what it was all about.
Wow.
I must, say at this point, I felt stupid.
Because you felt like you were giving up something.
Really?
Your dream for something that you were.
Not necessarily that.
Mm-hmm.
I felt I was going into something I never knew anything about.
Okay.
Right. It was an uncertain future.
Yeah.
But there was that propelling force that was leading me and them.
Wow.
But I thank God I took those steps.
So Revival Valley Ministries International.
That's
you're
right.
The founder. Talk to us about the vision.
Point
mission.
Man, rather, you know.